हेलो वन एंड ऑल, माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर घनश्याम चौहान, आई वेलकम यू इन सोशल एंड प्रिवेंटिव फार्मेसी। आवर टुडेज टॉपिक इज सार्स, सीवियर एक्यूट रेस्पिरेटरी सिंड्रोम। सार्स मे कॉज ड्यू टू द कोरोना वायरस। सो एज वी आर मोर एंड मोर अवेयर रिगार्डिंग द कोरोना वायरस, दिस इज नॉट द फर्स्ट टाइम वेन कोरोना वायरस इज इन्वेडिंग द वेरियस पीपल्स। इन 2003 and 2004 also it has been introduced into the world for the first time, and again in 2019 it is well known worldwide pandemic. So this coronavirus is able to produce the severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS. Now in this today's presentation, what we will discuss, regarding the SARS-CoV-2 update on outbreak, the various health responses, testing, injection prevention and control, and additional resources. What is coronavirus and COVID-19? So as from 2003 we are suffering from this coronavirus. So first time in 2003 we have exposed to this coronavirus. Coronaviruses are a large family of viruses. Some cause illness in human and others causes illness in animals such as bats, camels and cavets. Human coronaviruses are mild illness such as common cold. Not all the people are having symptoms. Out of them, only 15 to 20% people are having the symptoms, and remaining all are become asymptomatic, but they have become the carriers. Severe acute respiratory syndrome is a viral respiratory illness caused by a coronavirus called SARS, associated with the coronavirus SARS-CoV. Previous coronaviruses have included SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV. Severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2 is new strain of coronavirus. In early it was the old strain, but this is the new strain, and it is more developed, it is more mutant. So coronavirus that has not been previously identified in humans. Human coronavirus origin. Here you can see the most likely ecological reservoirs for coronaviruses are bat. From the bat it has been developed, but it is believed that the virus jumped the species barriers to humans from another intermediate animal host. The intermediate animal host could be an domestic food animals, a wild animals, or a domesticated wild animals which has not yet been identified. Still we are in the dilemma that actually which animal has been introduced that coronavirus to us, especially this new strain COVID-19. Either it may be the civet, camel or bats, or in another discovery the snakes also has been identified as a source for this COVID-19, but not yet it has been finalized. Coronaviruses belong to the Coronaviridae family in the Nidoviridae order. Here you can see this is the genetic material of coronavirus, and this is the capsid, which is an external coating envelope. Corona represents crown like spike on the outer surface. It is a crown like spike at the outer surfaces. Thus it has named as a coronavirus, that's why it is called as coronavirus. Coronaviruses are enveloped viruses, minutes in size 65 to 125 nanometer in diameter, and contain a single strain RNA. This is the single strain RNA as nucleic material, size ranging from 26 to 32 kbs in length. If you see its structure, they are containing this RNA, genetic material, as genetic material, and this is the envelope glycoprotein. They are having the various glycoprotein like other viruses. and this spike protein is also there, through which they are attaching to the host. This is the lipid bilayer and membrane glycoproteins. The virus that causes COVID-19 is known as SARS-CoV-2. Because this is a new strain and it is more developed and mutant strain, that's why we are discussing about the COVID-19. Earlier SARS have not taken too much casualties, but this is the most advanced and most mutant strain. That's why it become pandemic and it is taking too much casualties. Too much death has been occurred due to this new strain. It appeared to have first emerged in Wuhan in China in late 2019. The outbreak has been spread across China to the other countries around the world. By the end of January, the new coronavirus has been declared a public health emergency in international concern by WHO. The most commonly reported symptoms include a fever, dry cough, tiredness, and a mild cases, people may get just a runny nose or a sore throat. In the most severe cases, people with virus can develop difficulty in breathing, means they are having condition like dysapnea, and may ultimately experience organ failure. Some cases are fatal. Now this is the timeline, how it has been developed and how it has been spread, means from day to day, from the December 31st to the April 10. What is the condition of COVID-19 that we can discuss here? So on 31st December 19, China alerts WHO to several cases of pneumonia with known causes in Wuhan. The disease goes on to be named COVID-19. In January 7, WHO officially announced they had identified a new virus named SARS-CoV-2 that causes COVID-19. It belongs to the coronavirus family, which includes viruses that cause SARS, MERS, and the common cold. In January 11, China announces the first death linked to COVID-19. In January 13, WHO reported the first case outside the China in Thailand. In February 26, National Institute of Health began to first clinical trial in US for potential COVID-19 treatment, remdesivir, as an antiviral drug originally developed for Ebola virus. In February 29, the FDA took steps to expand novel coronavirus testing to hospital clinical microbiology laboratories. In March 11, WHO declares COVID-19 a pandemic, means from the 11 March it has been declared as a pandemic with more than 1 lakh cases and 4,000 deaths in 114 countries. And in April 2, confirmed cases of COVID-19 top 1 million worldwide. And April 10, global deaths due to COVID-19 is 1 lakhs. Now COVID-19 worldwide to 29 June 2020. So in this fashion, the graph has been inclined and still it is in inclined condition. After 1 year also, still the condition is same. As we saw in the April 2020, the patient was emerging there, the graph has been inclined. And route also in April 2021, the graph has been again inclined. This is the second phase for COVID-19. The new cases over the time. So in this fashion, the new cases has been fined. And after that, after the April, means from the May, the number of cases has been declined. COVID-19 cases and tests reported in the national survey up to 20 June 2020. So number of cases overseas and week ending. So in this fashion the cases has been increased, and how much test we have done, and how much death has been occur. So in this fashion the number of patients which has been recovered by the dark color and not recovered by blue color, others and died. So here mostly the people who are above 60, they are having higher chances for death, and who are below that, means below 55, they are having less chances for death. So the chances for death occurs from age of 55, and it has been increased by the years, by their age. February 2020, the National Health reported to the outbreak of coronavirus first reported in China in December 2019. WHO has declared that official new name for the virus that also formally went by the names 2019 novel coronavirus or 2019 nCoV, or now it is known as SARS-CoV-2, which causes COVID-19. This name change is to differentiate it from other coronavirus outbreak that include the common cold, but also the severe acute respiratory syndrome and Middle East respiratory syndrome (MERS-CoV), which have previously afflicted the world. National response. The government's health response to the COVID-19 outbreak aims to minimize. So these are the points that we should know and we should do for prevention or minimize or to control this disease. Minimize the number of people becoming infected or sick with COVID-19. So by the various ways we can minimize the number of people who can infect. Minimize how sick people become and the mortality rates. So by providing various facilities, by giving drugs, by providing the ventilators, by oxygen, so we can minimize the mortality rates. Manage the demand or on our health systems. So we should manage the demands what the health system requires. Help you to manage your own risk and risk to your family and community. So by making awareness to the people, to the family, to the society, we can make them more knowledgeable and more educated that they should aware with this disease and how to minimize the number of people being infected by using the mask, by doing the social distancing, by not coming outside into the market, by which we can minimize the infected patients. Now this is the way by which we can do. This is the uncontrolled group. This is the quarantine plus isolation. What we are doing, once the patients having symptoms, what we are doing, doing the test. By doing test, patient is confirmed positive, and after that we are making them for 14 days quarantine and isolations. And this is the quarantine plus isolation plus social distancing. And once the patient has been recovered from this disease, again we have to maintain the quarantine and isolation and also social distancing. Means in future there should not be any chances for reinfections. So in this fashion we have to continue this process. Now health responses. Infection with COVID-19 is notifiable conditions under the NSW Public Health Act. So all cases and suspected cases must be reported by the doctors and pathology to the health department. The health department have implemented a range of measures to promptly identify cases of COVID-19 infections and prevent transmission in NSW, leading and coordinating a state-wise response. The National Health Response to COVID-19 Should a person NSW be confirmed to have COVID-19 infections? The National Health has procedure in place to identify people they have been in close contact. Means first we have to find out the person who is in close contact. Those people are provided with the advice about self-isolation to minimize the spread of infection. If person will become self-isolated, means there are less chances for spreading of infections. Also, National Health Committee response included, establish a NSW COVID-19 clinical council and 30 clinical communities in practice across clinical specialties to support the response to COVID-19. Provide advice the general practitioners, pharmacists, emergency departments and the broader health system in the situation as it involves to the enable possible cases to be rapidly identified, diagnosed and managed. Developing diagnostic tests through specific health laboratories to rapidly diagnose cases. Developing diagnostic tests through public health laboratories to rapidly diagnose cases. Offering testing at public COVID-19 clinics throughout the states. I mean, throughout the states, we should follow this testing. Managing any cases with appropriate infections prevention and control and public health measures to minimize the risk to health care workers and community. Providing regular updates to community through media briefings, media release and social media, including in community languages. Case definition, confirmed cases. A person who tests positive to validated specific SARS-CoV-2 nucleic acid test or has a virus isolated in cell culture in PCR confirmation with a validated method or undergoes a seroconversion to or has a significant rise in SARS-CoV-2 neutralizing or IgG antibody level fourfold or greater rise in titer. So by any ways, by rapid test or that PTCRT or by any ways you are identifying the patient is COVID-19, we should confirm the cases first. Once you are confirmed, after that you can proceed. Clinical criteria. These are the clinical criteria for identification by symptoms. Fever. If person is having temperature more than 37.5 degrees Celsius or history of fever or night sweats or chills or acute respiratory infections. For example, patient is having cough, shortness of breath, sore throat or loss of smell or taste. Mostly this occurs in case of the asymptomatic patients or who are having very mild symptoms. Probable cases. A person who has detection of SARS-CoV-2 neutralizing or IgG antibody and has had a compatible clinical illness and meet one or more of the epidemiological criteria outlined in the suspect case definition. Suspect case. Clinical and public health judgment should be used to determine the need for testing in hospitalized patients and patients who do not meet the clinical or epidemiological criteria. Epidemiological criteria. In the 14 days prior to illness onsets, these are the various criteria that one should know and one should keep in the mind. Close contact with the confirmed or probable cases. We should identify the person who are in close contact with that patients. International and interstate travel. If any person have रिसेंटली डन इंटरनेशनल ट्रैवल एंड दे कम रिटर्न बैक टू द होम और एनी इंटर स्टेट ट्रैवल, सो हैव टू इमीजिएटली डायग्नोस और इमीजिएटली आइडेंटिफाई सच पीपल एंड वी शुड आइसोलेट देम, वी शुड गिव देम फॉर आइसोलेशन फॉर 14 days. पैसेंजर्स और क्रू हु हैव ट्रैवल ऑन ए क्रूज शिप, सो द पर्सन हु हैव रिसेंटली कम अक्रॉस आफ्टर द क्रूज शिप ट्रैवलिंग, दे शुड ऑल्सो इमीजिएटली आइसोलेट एंड शुड क्वारंटाइन फॉर एटलीस्ट फॉर 14 days और मैक्सिमम एट 28 days. हेल्थ केयर एज्ड और रेजिडेंशियल केयर वर्कर्स एंड स्टाफ विथ डायरेक्ट पेशेंट कॉन्टैक्ट्स, द हेल्थ केयर वर्कर्स हु आर कम इन द डायरेक्ट कॉन्टैक्ट विद द पेशेंट्स, दे शुड ऑल्सो क्वारंटाइन. पीपल हु हैव लिव्ड इन और ट्रैवल्ड थ्रू जियोग्राफिकली localized area with a elevated risk of community transmission as defined by the public health authorities. So in this patient there are the various criteria by which the patient should be quarantined for at least 14 days. Now COVID-19 close contact definitions. Close contact is identified as requiring face-to-face contact in any setting with a confirmed or probable case for greater than 15 minute cumulative over the course of a week in a period extending from 48 hours before onset of symptoms in the confirmed or probable case, or sharing of a closed space with a confirmed or probable case for a prolonged period, that is more than 2 hours in the period extending from 48 hours before onset of symptoms in the confirmed or probable case. Now infection prevention and control strategies. Now here we are having great role in prevention and control of this disease, because we should prevent the prevention is better than the cure, so you should prevent that disease as much as we can. Now there are various roles of various government and non-government organizations. It may be the various peoples like doctors, physicians, the government officers like that. Now general principles for infection prevention and control to prevent or limit transmission of COVID-19. Early recognition of patient who have suspected probable or confirm COVID-19. So you should early recognize, you should identify by the various criteria due to their traveling, due to the symptoms, or due to the close contact with the COVID-19 patient. So we should do the early diagnosis. Second is physical distancing during COVID-19 outbreak. So you should make the physical distancing at least 1 to 2 meters at least. You should do the social, that physical distance with the patients. Respiratory hygiene and cough etiquettes. In respiratory hygiene, we should use the good quality of mask to prevent our respiratory tract waste material to go outside, or the external droplets, they should not enter into respiratory tract. So for maintaining that, we should use this that mask, or you should use the shield to cover our face completely, to cover our all the body parts, they should not exposed too much. Management of patient with acute respiratory symptoms and or suspect or proven COVID-19. So you should do the management of the patients who are having this COVID-19 by various ways, by giving the drugs, by giving their proper food, by giving them proper consultation, because if you will keep them happy, it will improve their mental state, and if you will improve their mental state, definitely they will improve their immunity as well, because immunity plays here great role into the patients. If they are having good immunity, they will start to show good response for the therapy. Application of standard precaution for all patients at all the times. Should tell the patients regarding what precaution they should take in future. Implement transmission based precaution based on the risk assessments. So how the transmission will occur, how can we prevent the transmission, that education we should give to all the peoples. Isolate and apply infection prevention and control precautions. Standard precautions including hand hygiene, 5 movements for all patients. We should wash our hands again and again. Patients and health workers should observe respiratory hygiene and cough etiquettes. Means everybody should use the proper mask and hand gloves to maintain the respiratory hygiene. Transmission based precaution for patient with suspected, probable or confirmed COVID-19. So transmission based precaution we should take with suspected or probable COVID-19. Contact and droplet precaution for routine care of patients. So for contact means we should not touch directly, we should use hand gloves or try to avoid the direct contact. For example, we should not do shake hand with the people, we should not hug to the people, and we should use the proper mask to avoid the droplets should be entered into our respiratory tract. Contact droplets, airborne precautions by respiratory aerosol generating procedures. Aerosol generating procedure are defined as any medical and patient care procedure that results in the production of airborne particles less than 5 micrometers in size, which can remain suspended in the air, travel over the distance and may cause infection if they are inhaled. For example, AGP can be found in the coronavirus disease 2019. COVID-19 transmission. Generally, SARS-CoV-2 is spread by larger respiratory particles. These larger respiratory particles are responsible for transmission. So larger particles of liquid referred to as a droplet. These larger droplets particles tend to fall on adjacent surface. Any hard surface, for example floor, tabletop or table or any sort of hard material, chair, any material. So relatively quickly and do not travel along distance. So when we are repeatedly touching to that hard substance, hard material, so from one person it can invade to the another person. Means the transmission will occur when you are touching it, when one person will touch and the same material has been touched by the another person. So in this fashion the transmission of that virus through the droplet or through the liquid can be occur. Traveling over long distance on air current is generally not a significant factor in the spread of these infections. Precautions for COVID-19. Contact and droplet precautions. Now this precaution that one should take. Addition to airborne precaution for respiratory AGPs. So you should make the additional precaution for airborne respiratory AGPs. Whatever the droplets, whatever the aerosols, so small droplets have been produced, so against them you should use the proper precaution, like you should use wear the mask or you should use the PPE kit. Hand hygiene, you should routinely wash your hand after each hour and by using the good soap or liquid soap you should wash your hands. So hand hygiene should be there. In spite of using the various another equipments, like we are using the sanitizers, so in spite of sanitizers we should use the hand wash. Environmental cleaning, so you should clean the environment properly so that no any debris or no any sewage should be spread or should be able to invade or should able to increase that contamination from one place to the another place. Cleaning up shared patient care equipments. So if the shared patients are there, in that case, if you are using the same thing to the number of patients, you should try to avoid that. Or when you are sharing that, at each time you should wash that cloth or you should wash that equipments, and then you should use for the another patients. On presentation or admission to hospital, the patient should be, now what, when you are doing admission to the hospitals, so what you should do, these are the various criteria, various guidelines that you should follow. It is very, very must. That first is given a surgical mask to put on. Whenever you are entering in any hospitals, so you should give a surgical mask to the patients. Place in a single room. Ensure air does not circulate in the areas. So one person should enter into the single room. It should not happen that a large ward is there, and in that ward more than 100 patients are going to be under the treatments. So it should not happen. For each patient, you should keep in a single room so that the air should not circulate from one room to the another room. But in our India, what is happening? In one ward, in a one large room, so more than 20 patients or more than 100 patients are there, and they are taking the treatment under the one roof, which is not good for their health, which is unethical, because due to which the spreading will occur from one patient to the another patient, though the patient has been recovered. But if the patient who is beside him, if he is under the treatment and he is having the infection, so he can spread his infection toward the patient who is already cleared, who is already come out from that infections. So the reinfection may be there. So for avoid that, we should use the single room. Place in a negative pressure room in the event of AGP being performed. If transfer outside the room is essential, the patient should wear a surgical mask during transfer and follow respiratory hygiene and cough etiquettes. Means we should not do coughing in the public place, and we should use the proper mask by proper way. And also, if it is possible, we should use the shield also to avoid that droplets to come out from our mouth. Contact and droplet precautions. For close contact, 1.5 meter between a health worker and patient, the following PPE kit is safe and appropriate and should be put on before entering the patient's room. An apron or a long sleeved impervious gown. So either you should use the apron or long sleeved gown we should use. Surgical mask, it is must. Surgical mask, especially the good mask like N95 mask, we should use. Safe glasses or face shield. So for avoiding the transmission, you should use the glasses, because through eyes also it can get transmitted into our bodies. Or face shield also we should use. Disposable non-steroid gloves when in contact with patients. So you should use good sterilized hand gloves when you are touching to the patients. Personal protective equipments for AGPs. P2 or N95 respirators are used for airborne precautions when respiratory AGPs are conducted on patient with suspected, probable or confirmed COVID-19, and must be discarded following the AGP along with fluid resistance long sleeved or isolation gown, eye protection, safety guards, safety glasses or face shield we should use to protect our eyes from the infections. Disposable non-sterile gloves when in contact with the patients. Hand hygiene before dunning and after removing gloves. So we should use the disposable non-sterile gloves. Once you use, you should throw it. You should dispose it. Now, when we are entering into the hospitals, so for the staff, when they are entering into the contact or droplet precautions, so what they should do? So these are the various points they should, you should follow. So they should wash the hands, perform the hygiene, after that put the long silence gown, after that they should use the mask, after that put the protective eye wear, means they should use the gloves, after that perform the hygiene again and put the gloves. So in this fashion they should do it for each time when they are contacted with the patients before, and droplets are there and airborne precautions are there. So whenever they are in, because when you are in touch with the patient, when you are in that room where the lots of patients are there, so there are definitely chances to get infected, to get transmission from the patient to the physicians or the doctors or nurses or any medical healthcare workers. P2 or N95 mask fit kit, unless used correctly, that is with fit checking, the PA2 or N95 respiratory mask is unlikely to protect against airborne pathogen spread. This is the good quality of mask, N95 mask, that you should use. There is 100% chances of avoiding transmission. But in the market, various types of mask has been entered, but out of them, which one is N95, that you should identify, because there are various types of dummy mask has been produced by the various companies. You should go for the company who are the genuine one and who are really producing N95 or P2 type of mask. An airtight seal may be difficult to achieve for people with facial hairs. Fit checking with the range of P2 or N95 respiratory must occur to assess the most suitable one to achieve protective seal. We must protect ourselves. That protection is the best part to avoid the transmission. If a tight seal cannot be achieved, facial hair should be removed. The improved face of P2 or N95 respirator fit check. So it should properly fit to our face. So you should check it. So these are the ways how to wear that mask. The various points, the various procedure has been given in this. Infection prevention and control principles. So these are the principles by which we can prevent the infections. That first is environmental cleaning using a hospital grade and TGA approved infections. It is the, so the various good preparation produce approved, or the various like US FDA or the various goods manufacturing approval is there. They are providing the approval for these disinfectants, for their alcohol content or for their various chemical content. So we should use the good cleaning agents for washing our hands. Waste managements, follow routine clinical and non-clinical waste processes. So whatever the waste materials are there, we should dispose them very fastly, like PPE kit or gloves or mask or the body, whatever the dead bodies are there of COVID-19 patients, you should immediately dispose them. So waste management is very, very important. If you are not doing waste management, so you are give rise to the that infection to be invade to yourself, not only yourself but also for other patients. So waste management is very, very important. Utensils, follow routine cleaning processes. So whatever the various utensils which you are required to clean your areas, that's why the sanitary workers are having great role into the cleanliness of your hospitals. They are also having a key role to maintain the hygiene into our hospitals. Without cleanliness, how can we maintain the cleanliness, how can we maintain the hygieneness into our hospitals? Because if there are waste materials, if there are the garbages into the hospitals, they are spread here and there, so it will give rise to the another infections, or infection can be increased in the numbers. Linen managements, follow normal processes. Hand hygiene using ABHR or hand washing. So this is the standards by which how we are maintaining the alcohol into our hand washing. So it is a ABHR or hand washing. So good hand washing, by using good hand washing, we can avoid the spreading of transmission of that virus from one person to the another person. Respiratory hygiene and cough etiquettes principle applies. So for respiratory hygiene, what are things that we can do for us? For example, using of mask or social distance or use of the gown or shield. So that all things we should do it. And PPE transmission based precautions. So PPE kit also do transmission of that viruses. So for it also, you should, once you have used PPE kit, you should dispose it immediately. PPE staff education for dunning, for doffing PPE is undertaken for staff managing cases. Opportunity to ensure training of staff is up to date. Limited stock of PPE should not be used for training, and other models of training should occur. Removing PPE, there are a variety of ways to safely remove PPE without contaminating your clothes, skin or mucous membrane with potentially infectious materials. See two examples below. Example 1, gloves, gown and or apron, goggles, face or face shield, mask or respirators. Example 2, gown and gloves in combined motion, goggles or face shields and mask and respirators. After that, use the hand hygiene. You should wash your hands. Perform hand hygiene immediately after glove removal. Before removing face protection, before removing mask, respiratory, after removal of any contaminated items. So in this fashion, in this sequence, you can remove your various articles, and you should do the hand washing, and after that you should do your body washing also. Facility preparedness for COVID-19. These are the various facility that one should go. That first is staff needed and suitably to be trained with high level of PPE or COVID-19. Training should and staff training in high level of PPE combined precautions. Consumable required availability, easy to locate and accessible to the staff. Consumable required available, easy to locate and accessible to staff. Emergency department trained and up to date with personal protective equipments, competency and combined precautions. Intensive care or critical care departments trained and up to date with PPE, competency and combined precautions. Pandemic plan in place, reviewed and updated. Investigation. Arrange for COVID-19 testing if recommended by the risk assessments. So laboratory testing for SARS-CoV-2 continue to evolve rapidly with the accumulation of clinical data and as reagent and protocols are refined. The aim of testing, if clinically appropriate, exclude common respiratory viruses using local hospitals and community nucleic testing capacity. So there are various ways to do testing. Samples for testing: upper respiratory tract samples, lower respiratory tract samples, and serum. Upper respiratory tract samples: a nasal or oropharyngeal swab, maybe Dacron or Ryon, through the flocked preferred oropharyngeal swab or tonsillar beds and back of the throat, avoiding the tongue. Deep nasal, using a pencil grip or while gently rotating the swab, insert the tip 2 to 3 cm into the nostrils parallel to the palates to absorb mucus secretions. This is the way by which you are taking the swab samples for testing COVID-19. Advice for health workers, staff, health care students and volunteers. So in the national or government health recommends that any health worker or healthcare students for volunteer with respiratory symptoms or expected fever more than 37.5 degrees Celsius should be tested COVID-19 and immediately self-isolate, and routinely they should do this testing. They should not return to work duties until they have been tested and cleared from the COVID-19 infections. Symptom of COVID-19 includes fever more than 37.5 degrees Celsius, cough, sore, scratched throat, and shortness of breath. Other reported symptoms like COVID-19 include loss of smell, loss of taste, runny nose, muscle pain, joint pain, diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, and loss of appetites. The health worker or healthcare students or volunteers must also follow the some isolation guidelines for people suspected to have COVID-19. There are a number of COVID-19 testing clinics throughout the national government organizations. General practitioners and emergency department can also perform COVID-19 testing. Advice for health workers, staff, healthcare students and the volunteers into the national government hospitals. If a health worker or a healthcare student's volunteer is tested positive for COVID-19, they must follow the national guidelines. If health worker or a healthcare student or volunteer has tested negative of COVID-19 and continue to experience respiratory symptoms or unexplained fever, they should be medically assessed prior to return to the work or duties. If a health worker has been informed that they are close contact for COVID-19 by either the healthcare facility or local public health unit, they must inform their manager or supervisor. So students, in this session we have covered this topic. If you like my videos, please press the like button and share my videos as much as you can. Okay, so then bye for today.